So we got a big game coming up between the Ravens and the Bengals, and this is a statement game for both teams, because for the Ravens, they could take a commanding lead in the AFC North by moving to 6-1. Or for the Bengals, if they were to somehow go to 5-2 with a win over the Ravens, they'd be in first place in the AFC North. And this would really show that they can compete with the big boys. So what better way to find out a lot more information about this Bengals team than one of their own? And in this last check-in before the Ravens and Bengals game, we're bringing on my guy, a very special guest. Let's do it.
Yeah, this feels like a dream. And you know just what I mean. You see my boy, he like gotta made it, gotta made it. Boy, he's a fan and he like the Ravens, like the Ravens.
All right, so YouTube, team, keep it clean. We got a very special guest in the building. My guy, Ace Boogie from New Stripe City. And he is repping Cincinnati Bengals. So first, before we get into this, go ahead and introduce yourself. Let everybody know where they can find you at on Twitter, your website, YouTube, everything that you want everybody to know.
Yeah, definitely. I'm Ace Boogie of New Stripe City. You can find most of my stuff on YouTube at New Stripe City. You can also find me on Twitter at New Stripe City. And if you also are interested in AFC North football, you can find me on the AFC North Talk channel as well.
Okay. And how did you become a Bengals fan?
Man, that's a great question. So initially, I was born and raised in Cincinnati. My parents ended up actually getting a divorce, and my mom moved us to California, right? But during the summers, I would go back to Cincinnati. And then my parents ended up actually getting back together. This was about in the early 2000s. Okay. And we moved back to Cincinnati. And at the time, I had become familiar with the NFL, but the only players that I really knew at the time were Jerry Rice, because I lived out in California, Barry Sanders. Mm-hmm. I collected football cards, right? So I knew kind of what football was, but I started to get into adolescence when it was time to actually become a fan. And I happened to be back in my hometown of Cincinnati. And so when I started to watch the Bengals, we, believe it or not, obviously recently we've had our struggles, but those were the biggest struggles that we had. It's kind of when I came back in the late 90s, the early 2000s, pre-Marvin Lewis. And so I remember watching this team and just becoming super invested because I wanted to see them do well. And I remember like watching the draft and all kind of things. It just made me a huge fan because I just literally wanted this team to get better. Then we got Marvin Lewis and things started to turn around, and I felt like I started to get rewarded for being loyal to the team. And then, you know, the Carson Palmer era with Chad, Ocho, yeah, like nice. Things just go crazy. And I remember being in the city in high school in 2005 and how electric the city was. Yeah. And, you know, no matter what we went through, bad luck or not, you know, I just stuck by my team. And, you know, even when I went and moved away for college and moved to Florida, I still watched the Bengals every single chance that I got. I would go to B-Dubs to watch them since they didn't show them locally. Right. And, you know, met friends. Decided to just keep it going, bro. And that's what it's really been. Like, that was my team. I stuck by them. And that's how I became a Bengals fan. I actually ended up witnessing, I didn't know it because I got tickets from my substitute teacher, or not substitute teacher, but one of my teachers. I got tickets to the Seahawks game. I did get tickets to the Seahawks game, but the first one was the Bengals Broncos game in 2000, I believe. And Corey Dillon broke the rushing record and they won. And I didn't know it, but at the time, that was the very first win ever in Paul Brown Stadium. So I have a deep connection. The Seahawks game when I went, that was the birth of Rudy Johnson. I believe Corey Dillon was in a car accident before the game, and I was there to witness, like, the start of the Rudy chant. So it's just been my team. It's my city. So I always support them no matter where I'm at.
Hey, that's cool, man. I didn't know all that, man. So, but as a Bengals fan, what has been – your best moment as a Bengals fan?
Best moment as a Bengals fan? That's a good one. I would probably say the best moment and the worst moment was probably the 2015 the playoff game against Pittsburgh. That Steelers game. When Vontaze Burfict picked off Big Ben and we thought that we had it in our clutches, I would probably say that that was my proudest moment. A second one would be 2005 when it was time for us to play the Steelers once again in the first round. And Carson Palmer makes the deep bomb pass to Chris Henry. But then we all know that instantly turned into some of the worst Bengals moments for me as a fan as well. But I would say those ones. And then I would also probably say when we drafted this guy that's behind me, Adriel Jeremiah Green. Like I said, the Bengals turned me into a draft nerd. So that made me want to start studying, looking up highlights. And I remember when I saw AJ Green, he reminded me of Calvin Johnson when I watched him, because Calvin Johnson was a special type of receiver. And I was like, man, I haven't seen anybody like this since Calvin Johnson. And when the Bengals were able to pick him, because there were rumors that they could go with Blaine Gabbert. And I was just like, they cannot do that. They need to draft this kid, AJ Green, and do it. And literally when they drafted him, bro, I jumped up off of the couch. I was living with one of my college friends at the time. He was a Jaguars fan. We all mm-hmm. talked about the draft before it happened. And I literally jumped off of my couch when we drafted AJ Green. So I would probably say that those were my happiest moments as a Bengals fan.
Oh, man. Yeah, AJ Green, he brought us some very sad moments as Ravens fans. But one last question before we get into this game. How did you get started with New Stripe City, with doing the YouTube and really covering the Bengals on that aspect?
Yeah, the funny thing is when I started New Stripe City, I think it was about 5 years ago in 2016. Originally, the idea was for me to come on and have a roundtable with like-minded and individuals that I could relate to mm-hmm. about the Bengals. Like, we came on, it was called Bengals Real Talk. And initially, we had a lot of fun doing it. I think we did it on Google Hangouts, and we would do streams and stuff like that. But conflicting schedules, since we had so many people on it, it kind of became a thing where I could kind of put my most energy and effort into it and make it more efficient just by kind of doing it myself. And at the time, I experimented with different things. That's when I kind of started to get into video editing and stuff like that. And it was a mm-hmm. hobby. And then it just was something that I ended up enjoying. And the funny thing is, like, I've always been able to have a decent skill when it comes to talking about sports, right? Like, I could talk about the NFL, NBA, and people would always say, you know, you could be on ESPN or anything like that. But I was always passionate about the Bengals. And when I first got on YouTube, there wasn't much Bengals content. There wasn't any at all. I would get upset because I would try to search for Cincinnati Bengals, and there will really be nothing out there. And I'm like, this doesn't make sense, because I know that there's a whole bunch of diehard fans out there mm-hmm. That need this content. And so that's where it kind of started. And I just got more consistent and consistent with it. I had more moments and periods where I had to adjust, which you already know as a YouTuber, you have to adjust. But, you know, long story short, yeah. Laptop kind of got stolen, had to shoot videos off of my phone, you know, things like that. But growing that diehard fan base and keeping those videos going is what just kind of pushed me to try different things and propel my channel to where it's at right now with the Cincinnati Bengals and on YouTube.
Cool, man. All right, so Joe Burrow, how's that guy been looking?
Joey B, man, he's looking as advertised. I mean, a lot of people were kind of wondering why Bengals fans were so resilient about him, even though he went down with the injury. And this was the guy that we saw, you know, a guy that doesn't really look like a rookie, doesn't carry himself like a rookie, had his fair share of downs, right, in his rookie season, but not really many. Like, outside of that Ravens game, outside of the Steelers game, you know, outside of the end of the Colts game, those were probably his worst games. Outside of that, you know, really, really didn't play like a rookie. And it was kind of surprising just because he didn't have a preseason last year. And so this year going into it, we just knew that mentally Joe Burrow is just built different. Like, you know, he's just wired completely different. Coming from a Andy Dalton and a Carson Palmer, nothing against those guys, but they're not wired the same like Joe Burrow is. You just knew that he was going to do anything that he could to get back and play at a high level. And you just knew how smart he was. And if anyone could be able to do something like that, other than someone like Deshaun Watson, we knew that it would be Joe Burrow. So I think he's honestly played. I think he's probably exceeded some expectations to, like, the outsiders. I think that he's meeting expectations for certain insiders. And we also feel like he still hasn't even reached his full potential, because they have been kind of limiting the amount of passes that he's had in this year compared to last year, which I understand that they're trying to protect him as well. But I think that he is playing as advertised. He has had some miscues on some interceptions, but outside of that, you know, he's been as advertised, Joey B.
Now, one thing that, because I haven't gotten to watch much of him this year, obviously, I think this Sunday will be my first time really getting to watch him extensively because I did watch a bit of the Jaguars and Bengals game, and I a lot of respect because I see Joey B paying attention because I love how at the end of that game with that tight end screen that he talked about the reason that he audible to that because he knows that Jaguars defensive coordinator, he came from the Ravens. So he said, you know, they blitz heavy and whatnot. So he Wing better watch out this Sunday. So just sky some stuff so Joey B will be confused. But with him, something that I noticed last year when I watched him was that he played, in my eyes, he played a lot of hero ball to where he would always look to make that big play. And he would hold on to the ball, look, and always look for the big play. Now, how has he been as far as – because I know he in every game this year, he's thrown for at least 2 touchdowns. But I know he's thrown a good amount of interceptions too. How has he been when it comes to hero ball? Or has he been taking a check down more? How has he progressed as a quarterback from year one to year two? What has been like the biggest jump in your eyes?
I would say definitely the deep ball. You know, I think year one, that was an area that he definitely struggled with. And he worked on that this offseason. He's definitely improved his velocity and his accuracy on that. I think it's night and day. I think that was probably one of the weakest parts of his game outside of the hero ball last year. I think that he's dramatically improved that. I also think just his command of being able to read defenses and reacting to them and audibling at the line, I think that he's done a great job of that. As far as the interceptions with the hero ball, he's been kind of up and down with that because there's some instances where he has just taken exactly what the defense has given him. Mm-hmm. And I kind of saw it last week as well. But there have been instances where he has tried to force certain passes. And so I think that it's a bit of a balance. The weird thing is that he actually turned the ball over less last year than he has this year, even with less pass attempts and things of that nature. You still get it sometimes, but I think it's more reserved. Like, he does do things now where he will try to throw it away or, you know, he'll try to make the right decisions. But then sometimes, as we've seen in the Packers game coming out into the third quarter and even in the Bears game, he has had some misreads there where I'm not sure if it's a miscommunication between him and Tyler Boyd because there's the claim that, you know, those were option routes in some instances and he thought that Tyler was going to go a certain way and he didn't and throws the interception. Mm. But there definitely was one that comes to mind that he did force in that Packers game that he didn't have to. You're right, because the Bengals ended up getting the first down. You didn't need to take that chance, and he tried to force it into Auden Tate and ended up turning the ball over. And he had an interception last week, but I'm really not going to put that one on him because the ball went through Jamar Chase's hands. So it wasn't a unsafe throw. But I will say that he's had his ups and downs with the hero ball stuff. Like, for the most part, it's weird because he'll be extra safe. And then at some points in the game, he'll just take the chance. And then sometimes it might end up as a turnover. But I'd say overall, even after he's had kind of those interceptions, he has done a great job of bouncing back from them. But I don't think that he's at this point forcing it too much.
Okay. Now, a big part of a quarterback's game is obviously the offensive line. How has Bengals' offensive line been so far this season?
Yeah, I think they've been average. I mean, and if you ask the Bengals fan that last year coming off games where they gave up 8 sacks, I think that that's what you would want. Yeah. And I think that that's what the mindset was with them taking a player like Jamar Chase when you got rid of Bobby Hart, who was probably not even on the NFL roster now but was starting for you, and Michael Jordan, who's barely in the NFL right now, nothing against him. But those were two big weaknesses on this offensive line, and they went out and addressed that. They picked up Quentin Spain midseason last year. We all knew that he was a solid veteran that they could put in. Jonah Williams wasn't healthy. He's been healthy this season. They went out in the draft and got some solid guys there. Jackson Carmen, a rookie. So I think that they've been average. And to be honest with you, I think someone was actually telling me that a huge percentage of some of the sacks that have been given up actually have either been on Joe or running backs or someone that's not a lineman, which is, believe it or not, sounds kind of crazy. But the line has actually been pretty good, I think. And as long as they're solid, as long as they're in the top 20, I think that this team can do a lot of things because we felt like Joe Burrow did a lot last year with a horrible line. So we just knew if we were able to get somebody in there that could give him some time in that pocket so that he could step up. And I think that they've done that. And we know that the sky is the limit when you have that situation with them.
That's true. That's true. Now, you brought up the draft. Now, with this coming, I mean, this past draft, there was a big question for a lot of people whether the Bengals should take Sewell or Chase. Now, yes. Me, if you would ask me, I know how important offensive line is. I know it. You need it. It's important. Your team can't move forward if you don't have a good enough offensive line. But me, I would have took the more sexy pick in getting the right wide receiver. How? Because I know there was the whole debate. There was that what was it? The
the Civil War. Yeah,
Civil War. That's what it was. I remember that. So how do you feel it's worked out for y'all? I mean, we see Jamar Chase balling all the time.
Oh,
how do you feel
Chase
like it's worked out for y'all, man?
I think it definitely worked. And to be honest with you, when they went out and acquired Riley Reiff in free agency, I knew that they had a great chance of taking Jamar Chase because you got the chemistry that he already had with Burrow, so that's not really a concern. We had some aspects of the LSU offense here, and we also had a need for that third receiver with A.J. Green walking out off into greener pastures with the Cardinals. We knew that there was going to be about 100 targets that this offense was going to have missing. And so it made perfect sense to bring him in. The real thing was, what were they going to do at guard, right? Because even if they would have drafted Penei, the way that they set things up, they would have played Penei at guard. And then you have to ask yourself at that point, is a top five pick worth being spent at the guard position? And, you know, it made more sense to spend that at the wide receiver position. And it really has done amazing things for this offense, because now we finally have the deep ball back, which is something that we have literally struggled to connect with since Marvin Jones left, if I'm being honest. Like, since Marvin Jones left and they went and they tried the John Ross thing and they tried to get the speed and they tried to get it to work and it just wasn't working. That added a whole different dynamic to this offense, because now defenses can't guard you the same exact way. And they were able to do well in other aspects with getting Jackson Carmen, getting some guys that were better than what they had before in those lineman positions. And it's just completely worked out. Like, literally everything that they've done so far, from free agency to the draft to whatever, has clearly worked. I mean, Jamar Chase right now has top five NFL receiver stats.
That's crazy.
So, yeah, it definitely has worked out for sure.
All right, so getting into this game. As we know, under Lamar Jackson, the Ravens have definitely taken care of the Bengals ever since Lamar Jackson has been their starter.
Right.
What do you feel, first on defense, what do you feel like the Bengals need to do to try and win this game? What do they need to be most effective at, the game plan, whatever it may be?
Well, I would say the first thing is, like you said, they have historically struggled against Lamar Jackson. Many people may not know this, but a lot of the free agent signings and the draft moves that they've done, to me, have been in direct relation to them trying to be able to stop a team like the Ravens, specifically Lamar Jackson. In order to do that, I think that you're not going to shut down Mark Andrews, right? He's just too talented of a tight end, but you've got to try to limit him in this offense. And I think that that's something that they will try to do, because, you know, if Mark Andrews walks away with 80 yards and a touchdown, I think you're happy. What you can't let happen is Mark Andrews go out for 130, get a whole bunch of catches and two touchdowns. Like, that is just completely going to wreck your game plan. I also think when it comes to Hollywood, he's having a great season for you guys. You got to watch him as well. And then you got to shut down the run, which I think they've done a great job at doing this season. That's why they went out in the draft and invested so much in that defensive line. But I think with you guys being more of a passing team now, the issues that they have to worry about are the passing game, specifically for me, Mark Andrews and Hollywood Brown. And then you have to worry about the read option. When you look at this Bengals team, they've shut down some very good running backs, right? But they struggled in the Jacksonville game. And it wasn't because, and you know, nothing against the Jacksonville running back. He is a talented player. But the read option was something that gave them an issue. And we already know about the read option, Bengals fans, when it comes to Lamar Jackson, because we remember it from the very first game. That is what completely destroyed us. So they have to be able to stop the read option, and they have to be able to make sure that they limit the plays that Lamar Jackson can scramble, which is tough, right? Because it's ad-lib plays. But we'll have to see what their plan is. And you got to capitalize on turnovers. And if you do stop this Ravens offense or limit them to a field goal, you got to come back on the offensive side and put some points on the board. The Bengals have struggled with that, where this Bengals defense has played lights out and they've given opportunities to this offense and the offense hasn't cashed in on it. And so that is something that you're going to have to do, because you're not going to completely shut down the Ravens. I'm not going to sit here and say that this Bengals defense is so good that they can do that, because this Ravens offense has so many dimensions to it. You just have to hope to contain them. So I think that that's what they're going to try to do, is contain them and match them on offense and try to sneak out a victory.
Now, something that you just mentioned when talking about the Ravens offense, that they've been passing a lot more than they used to, which is true. And it's crazy that teams actually, like nowadays, they have to seriously scheme for a Ravens pass attack. How has the Bengals secondary been this year so far?
The Bengals secondary, I would say Cheeto is, man, he is an ascending player. He was a guy that when we signed him, I ended up talking with Vach Lombardi, who is an avid Cowboys fan. He had nothing but high marks to say for him. I watched him myself, and I was like, man, this guy could be a great signing for us. And he has been as advertised. I think he's easily the best corner on this team. He's been playing at a high, if not probably close to an elite level. I would almost put it at that aspect. But as far as the other cornerback position, that one has been a question mark for us, because Trey Waynes, once again, has been dealing with injuries, came back for one game, ended up getting hurt again. And so then they've been sliding Eli Apple over to that outside corner position. And he has had some ups and downs. Like early on, Eli Apple was the guy that was giving up the third and long plays and stuff like that. And people were attacking him. And then out of nowhere, he would have a good game. Then Trey Waynes came back. He went out. He played better than Trey Waynes. He only got targeted once last week, and he didn't allow a reception on that. So you don't know what you're getting with Eli Apple. Like, it's either bad or it's, hey, he actually played pretty solid. No one picked on him this week. But it's really just been that run of injuries there. And they also signed Trey Flowers. So I don't know if he's going to make his debut this week or if they're going to go with Eli Apple. I'd probably put my money on Eli Apple. And then in the slot, they've got Mike Hilton from the Steelers. And he has been very solid for them because he gets to do some special things. And I think that he's going to be a key part of this game, because they like to send him on blitzes and do all kind of Swiss Army knife stuff with him. But he has had some lapses in coverage at some points. But overall, I would say that the secondary is strong, because when you have Jesse Bates and Von Bell, they're playing some of their best ball. Now, they did have some issues. I believe it was in the Packers game. They had a couple of issues. But overall, the secondary has been – I think behind the defensive line, one of the strengths of this team.
Okay. What was Vontaze Burfict's number? Was it 55?
55, yes, sir.
And Vontaze Burfict, we know that he was definitely a crazy player. He brought it. No, he was an undrafted guy. I remember a lot of Ravens fans like hoping that, oh, he's undrafted. We should sign him. Mm-hmm. But y'all have another number 55 on the team right now.
Yes, sir.
And that would be Logan, right?
Logan Wilson, yes, sir.
Logan Wilson. And he has some very interesting comments to say about one Lamar Jackson. And initially, when I saw it on paper, just saw it written down, I was like, oh. But then I listened to it, and I was like, well, no, it doesn't sound so bad.
Right.
And then I even said, I made a whole video about it, talking about how Logan Wilson did. No, it was more like a compliment.
Right.
My thing was that I feel like his words, like he could have said it in the reverse order. Like he, it should have been like, oh, he's a quarterback that can play running back. But regardless, how did you feel about what Logan Wilson said about Lamar Jackson?
I don't think he meant anything by it. I think it was just, you know, like you said, giving him a compliment as far as he's not your average quarterback, right? You have to treat him like a running back with the way that he runs. And I mean, we sat up here and we watched Devontae Adams say that he watches Lamar Jackson's footwork, right? So that he can pick up on things that he can do with the ball in his hands, because I think Lamar Jackson is the only one that can do that with the ball in his hands. And so I think that that's what he was really saying there. And he even retweeted the story, because we've been through this with Bengals players from outside media that pick up on our local interviews and try to twist these stories. It happened with Ja'Marr Chase with the footballs thing.
Oh, yeah.
And so You get people that cut off certain pieces and they don't listen to the whole interview and they just take an excerpt, right? But Logan Wilson has complete respect for him. And in the tweet, he said that he's clearly an elite passer as well. And I think that it was just something dumb because, as you guys know, whenever somebody mentions running back and all of that, they know that it's going to be clickbait stuff and things of that nature. But no, I believe Logan Wilson has the ultimate respect for Lamar Jackson. And it was just something where I feel like they were just trying to do something for clicks. He definitely has the respect from Logan Wilson as a passer and as a runner.
Okay. And I think Logan actually picked him off before. But speaking of Logan Wilson, how has he been this season?
That man has been lights out this season. I will have to say, like, I think he's at 4 interceptions now, possibly 5. Like, he's having an amazing season. And I've been a big critic of the Bengals linebackers lately because this has been a position, even with Vontaze Burfict, they have not done a great job of addressing. Last season in the draft, they ended up picking up and adding some speed and youth to that position. And I think that has paid off coming into the season. That was the biggest question mark. And when I watched them last year and I saw Logan Wilson, I just couldn't understand why they kept playing Josh Bynes in front of him. I was just like, you got to play this guy more. But from what I was hearing, it seemed like they were worried with them not having a preseason and just being athletic. Yeah. They didn't want them to be out of place. So they wanted them to watch a veteran like Josh Bynes and Jermaine Pratt and just understand it before they gave it to him. But as soon as they did, man, this guy is – Bengals fans, you're probably going to remember the line of Vontaze Burfict all the way to Odell Thurman, that linebacker. Logan Wilson is the third in that line. Logan Wilson is definitely a game changer for this defense, and he's having a hell of a year, especially for him to be a linebacker with that many picks this early. And it's not even just that. Just, you know, he's always in the right spot. He is definitely one of the best linebackers that I think Bengals fans have seen in years.
Man, when you talked about Bengals linebackers, it sort of brought me back because I remember just maybe about three, four years ago, the Ravens had brought in Raymond Luga for a visit. So yes, that sir. You took me back with that because I know he did used to do his thing with the Bengals.
He did, but we have a love-hate relationship with Ray, man, because Ray, I think – the time period that he came in, right, you had those downhill thumper linebackers. They didn't really have to cover anyone and stuff like that. So I think Ray would have been great in that area, but he had some deficiencies, man. He would just – I think when we got him, we thought that we were getting this guy from USC that picked off these guys, and we were just thinking, you know, they had all of those great linebackers there in USC, and we just expected him to be that. And he wasn't bad. It's just he didn't live up to – the expectations and mentally sometimes he wasn't the best. Cause I remember when we drafted Vontaze at the time, Ray Maluga was an inside linebacker and Vontaze was so much better with his instincts that he ended up taking his position. And so there's been a love hate relationship with Ray, man. He was a lightning rod at some points with the Bengals, but I think overall he was still a solid guy. And once they started to move towards like a passing league, that's when it was like, it kind of got ugly for him there for a second.
Now, I remember last offseason, I remember talking to you about Josh Bynes.
Yes, sir.
Just how well he had done for the Ravens the previous year. And just how, he was never the fastest guy on the field, but he, with his instincts and with his smarts, he made a lot of plays happen for the Ravens. Now, speaking of LSU, Joe Burrow, his old teammate Patrick Queen, last year he was a rookie. And, of course, they didn't have an offseason. But this year he's had an offseason, so he's had a lot more time to improve and actually go through what an NFL training camp is. But Patrick Queen, he certainly struggled this year a lot. He struggled getting pushed back. He struggled with making tackles. He just struggled with what seems like second-guessing almost a lot of times, too. So what the Ravens did, they ended up signing Josh Bynes, who was a free agent, to their practice squad, called him up a couple games, and then they put him on the active roster. So now Josh Bynes, last week, Patrick Queen was demoted, and Josh Bynes took his spot, and that really solidified the defense and made them just play lights out against the Chargers. So switching it over to the Bengals offense, who we spoke briefly about. Now you said they've been the deep ball has been back.
Oh, the deep ball is back in a big way for sure. For sure. That's really been the lifeline of the offense, and it's all been to Chase. Chase is just whenever we need it, right? There will be stretches where you will see the Bengals offense go three and out, punt, score. All right, now we got 7 points, three and out, punt. And it's like, all right, now we're getting ready to go into halftime, and we get the ball after halftime, and then it's 60-yard bomb to Jamar Chase, touchdown. So it's been like that a lot this season. But I will say they have been trying to balance the run with the pass, and sometimes that has hurt them. So there's been instances where they may have run on like a 3rd and 7 and did a draw instead of going for a pass and something like that. But they've done good on 4th down conversions, but it's just been kind of up and down for this team. And I think last week was the first time, and I can't even say the first time because they put it together in the second half. But in the first half, we saw more of the same, except they actually went down and scored their first possession of the football game. And then you get back to the punts and the 3 and outs. But in the second half, they completely turned it on. And we've just been waiting for them to put it all on at the right points in the game. Because if they do that, I think if they would have done that last week, and it's funny because I said it without hearing Joe Burrow's press conference, I think that they could have scored 50 last week. They probably should have been up 21-0 at half. But I think that they're getting a good balance because they don't want Joe Burrow to throw more than 30 times a game. They want people to actually respect the run. And one of the things that was kind of a tell-all coming into the Lions game, and this is what I like about Zach, is he looks at what's going on out there and he adjusts. So there was a stat that came out that 80% of the time that the Bengals come out in the formation under center, they're running the ball, right? Ooh. Zach actually used that to his advantage last week, because he would come out under center and then we would run play action and stuff like that to keep the defense on his toes. But I think the major part of this offense, and I think that was a frustration with our fans, is that they were not using Chris Evans. Chris Evans, for those who don't know, 6th round running back that the Bengals took out of this year's draft, he's essentially the Giovanni Bernard replacement, right? I always compare him to Reggie Bush. He's very under the radar because he has some academic issues, but he actually was a top 50 draft pick. If you go back, I think a year prior to that, he was considered one of those prospects. And I think that he has an element to this offense that they need that does not make them predictable. Because when they come out under center and they come out in shotgun with someone like Chris Evans, who can catch out of the backfield, can line up at the receiver position and cause some mismatches, it truly makes them way more dynamic. Even if someone gets through, Joe Burrow can dump off to Chris Evans and he can do his thing. And we saw that last week when he came out, lined up, and ran the deep go for the first touchdown in the game. Now, the one thing that made me upset is right after that, they took Chris Evans out of the game. And so people were like, well, what are you doing? And in that second half, they brought Chris Evans back in, and then he was able to catch screens. He was able to pass protect. He was able to add different dimensions for the defense to have to account for. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you had Samaje Perine in there, people pretty much know that you're either going to run it or they're not going to really respect him as far as his route running and his ability to catch out of the backfield. And so I think that they did a good job with that. And then also CJ Uzomah. I think that he's been a guy that can also add an element to this offense, because sometimes if they get fixated on just the receivers.
Is that the tight end?
Yeah, that's our tight end. Okay. And so sometimes if we just get fixated on our receivers, people are just going to lock down on the receivers. They're just pretty much going to focus on them. And I think that when you have those other two guys in there, they add the dimensions where the defense has to account for both of those guys. And I think they kind of discovered that in the last game, but they have had their struggles. I'm not going to sit here and say that they've been super efficient, because they haven't been. They've been inefficient. And I think that they've fixed some things, but they are far from, I think, a perfect offense.
Okay. And Mr. Joe Mixon, how's he been looking?
Joe Mixon is looking good. I mean, this was something that we expected, as well as Bengals fans, and primarily because, and even with the offensive line as well, an overlooked thing was that Frank Pollock is the offensive line coach that the Bengals had in 2018, right before Zach Taylor took over, right? Zach Taylor actually made the decision to not keep and retain Frank Pollock, and people couldn't understand that because we had a line even back then that was probably as bad talent-wise as our line last year and the year prior, but he was able to make them a average line. So we knew that he was a good coach, and so we couldn't understand that. And Joe Mixon was coming off of leading the AFC in rushing that year. And so when you get him back, you know that Frank Pollock is a good offensive line coach, and he's also the run game coordinator. And Mixon has looked just like he kind of did in 2019, much better. He's had some injuries, but I've been surprised because when he had the ankle injury, he didn't practice all week, and then they let him play. You know, he played minimal snaps, but I had never seen that in this Zach era where he had allowed Mixon to play. And him and Mixon actually have a pretty good relationship. And then the next game, Mixon gets going. And the thing that I love about it and that Bengals fans have been waiting for is when this guy came out, he was comped to Lev Bell. They never used him like Lev Bell. They never would throw to Mixon out of the backfield, which was insane because he has hands as well. And I saw last game that they finally started going to Mixon in that aspect as well. So Joe Mixon has just been similar to what he was in, I want to say, 2018 or 2019, when he was one of the top five rushers in the league. And I think that's what he is statistically now, even though he's didn't even play in a bunch of snaps in, I believe, the Packers game. But he's been definitely a solid running back and definitely a dynamic that has helped this team as far as being two-dimensional instead of one-dimensional, because you need Joe Mixon to be progressive and efficient in order to get people to bite on those play actions. And that's what he's been doing.
Now, with your receivers, we all know about Jamar Chase. He's been doing his thing. But what receivers should Ravens really be watching out for? Because, you know, we got y'all got Tyler Boyd, too. Auden Tate. I'm not sure how the other guys are doing because all you hear about is Chase. But how are the other receivers doing? And do you think if Ravens really focus on Jamar Chase, then what other receivers could step up?
Oh, other receivers are definitely T. Higgins and Tyler Boyd.
Higgins. How did I forget about him?
Nah, you're good. Those guys, I think they could be in for big games because if you guys do put Marlon Humphrey on Chase or you double him, then it opens those guys up. With T. Higgins, he started off this year with a bang, mostly touchdowns and things like that. And he's actually gotten a lot of targets as well. He had one game where he was out with an injury, I believe, and then he came back. And, you know, he was a little rusty. He had a couple of drops that, you know, people kind of talked about after the game. Came back last week, had a pretty solid game. He's a guy that you definitely got to watch out for, especially if somebody is patrolling Chase. And Tyler Boyd, too. You know, a lot of people are going to look at his last two games and think that they were pretty quiet, which that was somewhat of a head-scratcher because, you know, he wasn't targeted in the Packers game in the first half. It was a lot of weird stuff going on, but after the game, he talked about being double-teamed. So I think Tyler Boyd is actually a guy that you have to watch for in this game because usually you put Marlon Humphrey on him. And in that Jaguars game, that was his biggest game this season, and I think he had about 9 or 10 catches in that one for 100 yards. So you always got to worry about – I call them the Migos. You always got to worry about the Migos. Chase is going to get his, but it's going to be real scary when all three of them together put it together. Like usually it's probably two out of the three that you kind of get to show up, and sometimes it's been T and Chase, or sometimes it's been Chase and T and Tyler Boyd. But I think if those three show up, then you have an issue. With Auden Tate, he doesn't get to play as much, and the only reason he played last week was because we were blowing the Lions out so bad. They just decided to bring him in. And, you know, they still have respect for Auden Tate, so they wanted to get him a touchdown to just let him know that they haven't forgotten about him. But he is another one, but I would probably say most of those targets go to – and honestly, it's just started to be Chase. Like, it started off being mostly Higgins and Boyd, and now that they've seen what they have in Chase – it slowly shifted to him a bit as well. But I think every game is different. And I think that that's one of the things that they do is, depending on what the matchups are, that's who they're going to go to. So all three of them are dangerous, but I would probably say those other guys if you focus on Chase.
Yeah, man. Just hearing you bring up, talk about that name, that Tyler Boyd, we Ravens fans, we got some tough memories with Tyler Boyd. Obviously, a lot more with A.J. Green, but Tyler Boyd, the most recent one, was just – it was rough.
4th and 12, man.
And I remember going into the Bengals game last year, the last Bengals game, where Ravens, like, they needed to win. A lot of Ravens fans were having flashbacks. They're like, why are we in this situation
with the Bengals? We've got the flashbacks.
Joe Burrow was out, and but it was still like one of those things where who was it? Was it Ryan Lindley that was a quarterback?
Ryan Finley.
But it was one of those things where it's like, man, I feel like when a team, when they don't have anything to play for, those are some of the most dangerous teams because they willing to throw everything out at you. And especially if it's an elimination game where if they could beat you, you could possibly miss the playoffs. It's like, oh, boy. But thank goodness that Ravens, they took care of business. So how do you think this game is going to go? Who do you think is going to win and why?
This is a tough one, man. I mean, with us playing in Baltimore, I think that changes the dynamics of this game. But I think that this is actually for the first time, I think, in a while, I think that this will actually be a pretty close game. And I think the first game of last year kind of started off that way, right? But we just couldn't really answer the bell and capitalize on any of the mistakes that were made by Lamar in that game. And I think that this one will be closer, but it's tough for me, man, because I'm on the AFC North talk show and you guys are always tough to beat at home. And so I think that in order for the Bengals to win this game, they've got to cash in on those opportunities and they've got to take it to this Baltimore team. And I think it's going to be very close early. I don't know who's going to get the ball at halftime. The Bengals have been undefeated on the coin toss this year, and they've always chosen to receive the ball at halftime.
Okay.
But I think that the X factor is really going to come down to Ja'Marr Chase and Marlon Humphrey. I think that this is probably the hardest corner that Ja'Marr Chase has gone up against. And so it's hard to say how this game is going to go.
Right.
But I think that it'll be a close game. I think both offenses will come to play. I think, man, you put me on the spot here.
Good.
I'm going to say 30-27.
Okay.
Ravens. I think the Bengals will have a really solid showing. I had them splitting with you guys this season, and I think that the game at home shapes up better for us, but I think it's 30-27 Ravens, and I just keep seeing Justin Tucker come through in the clutch for you guys at the end, and I just think playing on the road, man, it's always tough. Not saying that they can't do it, but that's just a tough situation.
Now, it's crazy because when I previewed this game, I didn't have a score prediction, but I also said that I feel like the Ravens will win by 3. because I feel like this Bengals team, they obviously better than they have been in years past. And this Bengals team, with them having only lost both of their games by a combined 6 points, that's crazy. Because I know you mentioned to me how the reason they lost that the Bears game is because they didn't stop a Justin Fields ramble. Yeah. And then the Bengals game, that was just wild in itself, man. So this team is – even through their losses, they've shown like, hey, yeah, we're here.
Right.
So I do expect this to be a close one. I expect this to be a really close one. So we'll have to see how it goes. But anyway, on the way out of here, let everybody know again where they can find you at, what you do, where they can follow you at on Twitter as well.
Yeah, certainly. New Stripe City on YouTube. You can also find me on the AFC North Talk YouTube channel. And then you can also find me on Twitter at New Stripe City.
All right, and I appreciate you joining us on here. We see how this game goes.
Thank you for having me, bro.
Oh yeah.
Shout out to Graven.